huge story tonight, breaking news.
It was explosive.
Ryan Seacrest and Juliana Rancic.
Jason and Maria here.
Justin Sylvester.
Live from E!
Live in London.
Live in Hollywood.
Let's get right into this drama.
Brad and Angelina's bombshell split.
Johnny Depp won in court yesterday.
Free Britney.
It's the royal wedding scandal.
Here to break it all down is entertainment attorney Nitra Ahurian.
Queen Elizabeth wore that crown for over 70 years.
There is a rift in this family, and the queen is not happy.
Delicious.
Hi, I'm Justin Sylvester with today's top stories.
Blake Lively and Ryan Reynolds are expecting another child. Blake showed off her baby bump during a red carpet event in New York City. And John Stamos is releasing a memoir next year titled, If You Would Have Told Me. He hit up Instagram and said he wants to honor those who made him who he is today. For more pop culture stories, check out Nightly Pop at 11:30.
I feel very, very fancy and lucky. Amazing.
It's custom, actually.
This dress is a showstopper.
Thank you so much.
Jay Mandel.
Vera Wang hooked me up.
Scarlett and K-Bell helped set the white-hot trend of the night. Jessica Biel brought the perfect accessory.
Little date night tonight.
Always. We always use these as a date night.
But the trend wasn't just for the ladies.
This is a Brunello Cucinelli.
I'm doing Stella Prada Roe Chanel.
Mandy Moore brought the glam.
I am wearing custom Rodarte.
Custom Rodarte?
Custom.
Wow. Even better than just regular Rodarte, I guess.
Literally, Laura was at my house with this fabric at my kitchen table, like, I think this could be a good fabric for the Emmys. I was like, yes, please, thank you, of course.
This dress is exquisite.
Thank you.
Who are you wearing this evening?
Chanel.
Issa Rae looked pretty in pastel pants.
There are 3,000 crystals on my dress right now.
3,000.
3,000. I was like, are you serious right now? They took 100 hours to make.
Ellie Kemper kept her look light and airy.
You're stunning. Nice to see you. Who are you wearing this evening?
Speaking of dresses, Jay Mandel. I think both of our dresses are accomplishing the staying cool components of the evening.
These ladies went bold and beautiful.
We've really upped the ante.
I'm wearing Pabo Guan. It's custom, actually. I asked him to make a dress for me that represents the Eritrean flag where my father's from, so he made me this.
Didn't have any real wardrobe snafus.
It's always a win.
No, I'm here chilling.
Who are you wearing?
Custom Christian Siriano.
You look fantastic.
Thank you. Custom Vera Wang.
What is your process for picking out a gown?
How do I feel and does it fit?
Those are the two things.
And will I be comfortable? Comfort, you can sell it. I don't care if it's a rag. If you feel good in it, if your body feels good in it, then you will sell it. The clothes can't wear you.
The hot couples at the Emmys were the perfect complement to each other.
I'm feeling it right now. You look stunning. Big date night for you guys. What are you going to do after the show?
After we're done, maybe we take a nap and then go to the governor's ball.
Who are you wearing? You look very
elegant.
I'm wearing Zuhair and Lorraine Schwartz.
It wouldn't be an award show without some fashion risk takers.
I bought this online.
You did?
Yes, I did. I do my own clothes.
Tatiana Maslany stayed true to the neon trend in a jumper. And Tracee Ellis Ross was all high fashion and Valentino haute couture. And we're not mad that the dress doubled as a blankie.
Good night.
Right when we got over the shock of Pete Davidson and Kate Beckinsale being together, they did this. Their tonsil hockey photo went viral, mostly because of Queer Eye star Anthony's photobomb.
Thanks, Petey and Kate.
The passion didn't last, though. Pete and Kate have since gone their separate ways. Sarah Hyland has something on the tip of her tongue, her boyfriend, Wells Adams.
I know, he's amazing.
In case you missed their Jumbotron lick-a-thon, Wells posted it on Instagram for maximum exposure. When Cardi B wanted us to know she was back with her husband Offset, she didn't tell us, she showed us. From the Grammys to the Billboard Awards, these two love to get tongues wagging. But come on, they do have a song together called Lick.
Licking like a quarter lick.
Look deeply into our crystal ball.
I try not to look.
Come on, it won't hurt you.
I'll see that smile.
And best of all, with the help of some powerful psychics, we're predicting what 2018 will bring for these celebs.
Here we go.
Let's put Brad and Angelina into our ball.
I see you.
Psychic Paula Roberts told Page Six these two will fall in love this year.
Congratulations, my man.
Just not with each other.
Angelina! Woo!
This was the last time we saw Angelina stepping out while the Paps recently photographed Mr. Pitt riding his motorcycle. And word is, Brad's got his flirting game in high gear. Brad was reportedly seen riding to an LA coffee shop where he struck up a conversation with a blonde in line who introduced herself as Lydia. Brad put out his hand and said, "Hi, I'm William." The lady responded, "Oh, you look like a Bradley." And Pitt said, "Well, that's my middle name," smiled and winked. Today, our source shares Brad can be flirty and has been on a few dates, but nothing serious. So bye-bye, William Bradley, and hello, J-Lo and A-Rod. Jennifer Instagrammed this hot vid of her man and the hope of the year to come, but she might not like what psychic medium Raymond Guzman has to say. He predicts heartbreak ahead for J-Lo. Well, if it's any consolation, our sources say she and Alex, as of now, are going strong.
I'm in love.
You don't need a crystal ball to know that, but here's a surprise. Psychic Paula, who happens to be British, predicts Prince Harry and Meghan will announce a royal pregnancy in August.
I just see it as a change.
And it will be a baby boy.
Another day, another drama.
Actually, no drama for a change. Paula predicts in 2018, Taylor Swift will finally settle on one guy.
Nerve-wracking.
We're sure Joe Alwyn will take it all in stride. And we end on Tay's pal, Selena.
Justin, are you going to propose to Selena Gomez?
Multiple sources confirm to E! News the two are in Cabo celebrating New Year's Eve together. So we'll let Justin's face be our predictor of what's ahead.
You guys make a really good couple. I see that smile.
Your home, see you later.
Here it is, my accommodation for the evening. It's been 30 years since Will Smith graced our screens on The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air, but believe it or not, you can stay here for $30 a night and make this entire place yours, which is exactly what I'm doing. Yeah, look around. So right now I'm in the Will Smith wing. You don't get the entire house, but you get this section where they've definitely set up some of our favorite parts of the show, including his amazing fashion, his caps, there's sneakers all around the place, and also an indoor basketball hoop. I nailed that. And as you can see, there's a fantastic games room, there's a piano, but I mean, Uncle Phil, you got a great shirt.
Looks like you eat here often.
How about this for a special treat for you guys and for me? Right now on the phone, DJ Jazzy Jeff. How are you, man?
I'm great, man. I'm just trying to figure out what are you doing in my house?
And I'm about to have one of the freshest stays of all time staying here. How good is this place?
Listen, it's awesome. It's awesome. Just make sure that you don't break anything and keep all of my stuff there because I'm coming back.
And what was that conversation 30 years ago where Will was like, you know what, Jazzy Jeff, you got to be involved in this show. It's going to be epic.
Well, you know what's funny is I'm so much into music that it took a little bit of a convincing, you know, and he ended up saying to me, like, listen, Jeff, they want you to do 3 episodes. If you do one and you hate it, you only got 2 to do. If you do one and you love it, you got 2 to look forward to. And Will is pretty good at twisting my arm and stuff. And next thing you know, it was 5 years later.
Man, I like that you've already got the record player here and it's good to go. Unfortunately, nobody can properly DJ with this, but you are doing some DJ courses for everybody if they can't make it to the house, correct?
Listen, I am giving out private lessons. I'm going to show some tricks of the trade, some cool tools. I am so excited.
You can't throw me out because I'm already outside.
Killing each other, that's not the way out.
Been a witness to homicides and drive-bys taking lives, little kids die.
He died extremely violently. We've never found the killer.
There was a huge crowd there, a lot of potential witnesses.
Las Vegas police are taking another look at the case.
I'm told that they're looking very closely at it.
One of the great artistic talents of his generation was cut short.
Ain't nothing but a gangsta party.
You rap a lot of your songs from a gangster's point of view.
From a thug's point of view.
From a thug's point, what's the difference?
Well, to me, gangsters die quick.
It was a gang-related brawl that led to Tupac's murder. On September 6, 1996, after watching the Mike Tyson match in Vegas with Death Row Records mogul Suge Knight, Tupac jumped Los Angeles Crips gang member Orlando Anderson.
One of the stories that is out there is that Orlando Anderson had committed a robbery on either Tupac or one of Tupac's friends and stole their necklace.
It was on videotape. I mean, they were going at it, and Tupac got the best of him. Within a couple hours of that incident, there was that confrontation out on Flamingo.
Suge and Tupac were on their way to a club. This is the last known photo of Tupac alive. Minutes later,
a white Cadillac pulled up next to Suge Knight's BMW. Tupac was in the passenger seat. Suge was driving. A shooter in the driver's side, back seat of the Cadillac unrolled the window, arm came out, opened fire, and just went rat-a-tat-tat. There were 13 shots fired. Tupac tells him, "You're shot, man," because Suge was shot in the back of his neck. And he said, "I'm shot, look at you." And they end up on the Las Vegas Strip. And the last thing he said to Suge Knight was, "I'm dying, man."
I was working on Las Vegas Strip. I was a sergeant. Tupac, he basically slumped out of the car when I opened the door. We have something in police work called a dying declaration. So I asked him, "What happened? Who shot you? Who did this?" And he was just kind of ignoring me, and he was trying to yell back and forth to Suge. He got a breath together, and I said, "Who did this?" He looked at me and he went, "F you." And that was it. He never regained consciousness again. I've received death threats. A lot of people, for whatever reason, don't like the fact that I was the last guy to talk to him.
A lot of people thought he would live through it. A lot of that was down to the fact that he'd survived another major shooting 2 years earlier.
I saw Tupac's body at the coroner's office during the autopsy, and he had a whole bunch of bullets in the middle of his chest. There was no way. He could have been shot in front of an emergency room, and he wouldn't have survived.
The night Tupac was shot, the next day, Saturday, Orlando Anderson gets back into Compton and goes all over the street telling everybody, "I shot Pac, I shot Pac." He was bragging about it. The gang cops identified Orlando Anderson to the Las Vegas Police Department. I got it straight from the street gang cops.
Orlando Anderson is the shooter.
Were you involved in any way in the death of Tupac Shakur?
Well, I was not involved.
And there was not enough evidence to prosecute him.
Because the police got absolutely no cooperation whatsoever. And I talked to those guys, all from Tupac's group, and they were all there at the shooting, and that night, nobody saw anything.
There's no doubt in my mind whatsoever that Suge Knight knew immediately who was behind the murder of Tupac Shakur.
Suge, who's currently in prison on unrelated murder charges, was allegedly a high-ranking member of the Bloods, Orlando's rival gang.
When somebody do something to get on, if you tell on them, that's called a snitch, a rat. In the suburbs, they call an eyewitness. It's a big difference.
18 months after Tupac died, Orlando Anderson was himself killed at a car wash. When someone big like that dies, it's tough to accept. There were lots of conspiracy theories rolling around.
I would suppose that the biggest misconception on this case was that it was Suge Knight being involved, not the case.
But, what do you do, say here, take a semi-automatic weapon, shoot it into the car and try not to hit me? He did get hit, so no, there's no evidence pointing to it. All the evidence points to Orlando Anderson in retaliation for being beat up at the MGM Grand.
It's only obvious that I wouldn't have nothing done to Tupac. on the simple fact that I love Tupac. I'm the same guy who was in the car with him and made sure that whatever happened, I tried to prevent.
Another conspiracy theory, the East Coast, West Coast rap war fueled the murder.
It came at the end of this long-running, very publicized feud.
I think the reason the public gets so obsessed with cases like this, you know, there was that theory that Notorious B.I.G. was involved. That was proved within days that he had nothing to do with it.
What police believe is that gang member Orlando Anderson fatally shot Tupac after the rapper jumped him earlier that night in Las Vegas.
A bad dude got beat up, so what did he do? He went and got a gun and got even later.
Orlando was killed less than 2 years later in an unrelated shooting. His uncle, former gang member Keefe D, who was in the car with Orlando the night Tupac was shot, claimed to police he had a private conversation with Biggie's record producer, P. Diddy, shortly before the murder.
This is according to Keefe D, and Puffy Combs tells him, I want these guys taken care of. According to Keefe D, during this conversation with Puffy Combs, there's a solicitation to go out and get these guys.
Diddy has vehemently denied the unproven allegations.
I don't think P. Diddy is responsible at all. There's really no evidence to that.
Now, Keefe may potentially be arrested as an accessory to Tupac's murder based on what he admitted in the BET documentary Death Row Chronicles.
I keep it for the cold of the streets. It just came from the backseat, bro.
He said he's the one who egged on the gang members to, hey, go retaliate, go find him.
We just pulled up on the side, checked every car, see where they were.
Keefe also confessed to being involved with the murder back in 2009.
He leaned over on the window, rolled down the window, popped.
But he made an agreement in which they couldn't use his own confession against him without other evidence.
Things have changed, though. Now we know that Keefe D has publicly admitted to his involvement in the murder of Tupac Shakur. He does not have those same self-incrimination protection rights that he had when he was dealing with us. So he could be prosecuted, and those statements can be used against him.
The LVPD tells E the case is still open. One thing that can't be disputed, Tupac getting caught up in the wrong crowd led to his death. His denial that he was a gangster has long been up for debate.
He was a gifted artist, but you know, in his heart, he was a hardcore gang member. You can't dismiss that.
Tupac hung out with gang members. His gang was music. He grew up in the jungle in Marin County in one of the worst low-income housing projects around. He never jumped into a gang.
What we're doing is using our brain to get out of the ghetto any way we can. So we tell these stories, you know what I'm saying? And they tend to be violent.
I wish I could take the pain away. If you can make it through the night, there's a brighter day.
It's my responsibility to be a true role model and show the world my faults as well as my good points.
I don't think that there will ever be justice for Tupac in the sense that anybody's ever gonna get prosecuted. It comes down to how do you define justice. The person who shot Tupac Shakur was shot and killed in the same violent way.
I believe that no one has the right to take another person's life.
Believe me, if I started murdering people, there'd be none of you left.
The killings were horrific, ritualistic, and shook Hollywood to the core, with bloody messages of pigs and helter-skelter scrawled on victims and their property. And now Charles Manson, the mastermind behind 1969's Summer of Terror, is dead at the age of 83.
I'm going back down in an old hole.
Manson had been serving multiple life sentences out of California prison since his 1971 conviction.
I'd take this book and beat you to death with it, and I wouldn't feel a thing.
His cult-directed killing shocked the world. August 8, 1969, actress Sharon Tate, the pregnant wife of director Roman Polanski and friends, including a celebrity hairstylist and heiress, were murdered in an unlucky twist of fate.
Friday night in Los Angeles, a movie actress and four of her friends.
The 26-year-old was living in an LA home previously occupied by a music producer Manson had a beef with. Manson sent four of his followers to the home to do his dirty work. Polanski was out of town. Tate, who was 8 months pregnant, was stabbed 16 times. The next day, a supermarket executive and his wife fell victim to Manson's followers.
Repeated stab wounds.
The evil act sent panic throughout the Hollywood community, creating a chilling effect that endured even after Manson and his followers were apprehended.
I'm the devil. You didn't know that?